It's another hour of In Deep. I'm Angie Coiro. You know the story of the woman who sued McDonald's over her hot cup of coffee? You probably don't really know the story because big business and insurance companies twisted that narrative to change the courtroom landscape nationwide, not in your favor. Surprise. This hour, the documentary film Hot Coffee, our discussion on In Deep. In our blogger spotlight this week, I'm going to take advantage of an email that I received from the folks at Forest Ethics. I know we all make an effort to be green, and most of us know about greenwashing, where a product appears to be more green than it is, more sustainable, more environmentally produced, or easier to dispose of. In the case of buying timber, or in the case of buying wood products, anything made from wood products, there are labels that you can look for that will tell you how green that item is. Or will it? That's what I'm discussing with Todd Paglia. He's Executive Director of Forest Ethics. Forest Ethics has a campaign underway to make those labels more legitimate and to ask companies to step away from the labels that are not. Todd, first of all, thank you for joining us.
Absolutely. Glad to be here.
And there's one label in particular that you folks have your eye on, and that is the SFI label. Is that right?
Yeah. You know, this is getting to be, I mean, there's very hopeful things and some very discouraging things. I mean, the hopeful thing is so many people are trying to buy green and do the right thing. And that's a great sign. And on the bad side, there are some 400 labels, many of them sponsored by the very industries that are doing destructive things like clear-cutting forests. And so it's a much more mixed picture than probably the average consumer thinks.
So this particular label is funded by the companies themselves, so we already have kind of a conflict of interest going on there. What does the label promise, and what does it actually deliver?
Well, it's interesting. The SFI, which is 100% funded by the logging industry, promises in sort of generalized terms that it's green. But when you actually look at what it allows old-growth logging, it allows logging in endangered species habitat, it allows logging on steep slopes that are likely to slide into salmon-bearing rivers. I mean, it's kind of like the laundry list of what you think a label that says green would not allow.
Is there anything green about it at all? It sounds like it means nothing.
It pretty much means nothing. What it basically does is require the logging companies to obey the law, and they already have to.
Oh.
So it really, the SFI means nothing. And unfortunately, it's actually a very deceptive thing that misleads a lot of consumers.
Well, for a consumer who's trying to buy green, it's often hard to tell what company is using what product. So in this particular campaign, you're not asking people to walk up to the clerk at whatever home store and say, hey, which timber are you using? You're asking companies to disassociate themselves with these timber owners. So you actually have some on board already. You have some successes under your belt.
And so far we have 20 companies that have dropped using this fake logging industry-sponsored eco-label. And the even better news is not only are they taking that label off of their products because it doesn't really mean anything, and this is big companies, and most recently companies like Pitney Bowes, Shutterfly, U.S. Airways, and others. And previously we had Office Depot and you know, some major companies just say, this doesn't mean anything, we're not going to use it anymore. And the other really good news piece of this is that many of them are shifting to the Forest Stewardship Council, which FSC, it's a little bit of alphabet soup here, but FSC is actually a label that means something. It protects the environment. It limits logging. It brings social equity issues into the equation. It's a very good system, the best system there is worldwide. And so that's something that these companies, not only are they dropping the SFI, which is meaningless, they're adopting and buying products that are sometimes a little more expensive but have FSC, truly sustainable certified product in them, whether that's wood, paper, or other wood-based products.
I'm talking to Todd Paglia. He's Executive Director of Forest Ethics. All the links and all the information posted online with us at indeepradio.com. So right now, Todd, in your sites you have Hannah Anderson and the Sierra Trading Post to tell them to stop using SFI. Let's talk about the impact of the consumer getting in touch as opposed to just your group per se saying, you know, oh, of course, they're Forest Ethics. They're going to tell us not to do this. It seems like there are so many different causes that people are active with nowadays. I look at someone like Sierra Trading Post, and some people are writing and saying, get the scripture quotes off your front page. Others write in and say, you know, get that kind of timber out of your product. What is the best way for a consumer to raise their complaint above that noise level?
You know, when we work together, when we pool our, you know, our power and our resources together, you know, that's when we have the most impact. And so, you know, obviously I want people to join Forest Ethics at forestethics.org, but it's really what cause sings to you, what means the most to you. If you're a forest person, then you should join with the 100,000 plus forest people that are with us at Forest Ethics. But there's a lot of great organizations out there. You know, Sierra Club is doing some amazing work around coal and climate change. Other organizations are taking up other, you know, other issues that are really important. But it's really, I think it's important to be part of a team. And that's where we have our greatest impacts. Consumers acting all by themselves, kind of one-off initiatives based on what they care about, but working alone, are a lot harder to get any real results.
Todd, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
Todd Paglia, Executive Director of Forest Ethics. This is In Deep. I'm Angie Coiro. Thanks for joining us for another hour. Hot coffee. Yum. Unless you have it in your lap. This is this story of hot coffee in a woman's lap from McDonald's, and she went on to make her personal fortune at the hands of the unfortunate company, who was, of course, doing what a company is supposed to do, serving hot coffee. There's a lot about that story you may have heard, and most of it is probably wrong. And that is the jumping off point for a film, Hot Coffee, by Susan Saladoff. It goes into and then well beyond the McDonald's case to look at our judicial system as it's been affected by corporations. Susan Saladoff, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
I must say, just to let you in on this, last week we talked about a documentary by Judy Berry, and I discovered that I, like so many other people, had really swallowed a lot of what turned out to be apocryphal information about Earth First, about their violence, about, you know, how they're a bunch of twisted, you know, maladjusted, unhappy individuals. And here to confront the same thing again, and I'm probably a typical American citizen, is I heard about this woman who ordered a hot cup of coffee and then was surprised to find out it was hot and went after a company for that. And it couldn't be less true. And I think what was so wise on your part as a director was to establish all that apocrypha first, and then to show the burns on this woman. Anyone who saw that picture would know this was not some irresponsible woman seeking her fortune from unfortunate McDonald's.
You know, everyone who sees the film, you know, afterwards I do a lot of Q&As, and I ask people, so how many of you walked into the theater thinking, how ridiculous is it for someone to sue over hot coffee when it spills on their lap? And how many of you think this was a frivolous or, you know, non-meritorious case? And everybody raises their hand. And then afterwards I said, how many now think that? And of course, no one raises their hand, because once people actually see the facts and what happened and how many times McDonald's was not just warned, but how many times they paid out for people who had been severely burned. I mean, these were, as you saw, these are not small burns. These are third-degree burns, the worst kind that you can have. And she needed skin grafting and surgery. So most people have the facts completely wrong, as you've said.
And even in the tiny points, and of course the tiny points are what go into making up the whole story, the stupidity attributed to this woman, not just the greed, but the stupidity, well, you know, she was driving and she put it in her lap, and what did she expect? Well, she wasn't driving. And those little points are those that coalesce to make the big misunderstood story. But it's not misunderstood. It was manipulated.
Well, you know, corporations have a big stake in making people believe that our judicial system is broken, that it needs to be reformed. And they've, you know, done a fabulous marketing job over the last 30 years convincing us, as, you know, to give up our own constitutional rights. And so there's been so much misinformation that's been put to us time after time, I mean, repeated over and over again. And as you saw in the film from one of our experts, Professor George Lakoff, who's a neurolinguistics professor at Berkeley, you know, he says when words are repeated enough times, the brain actually changes and people actually believe what they've heard so many times. And corporations knew that the only way that they were being held accountable when they made products that harmed us or when they pollute our waters or our air is in the civil courts. And if they could prevent people from actually getting access to the courts, then they can make more money. And that's what's happened over the last 30 years.
Well, let's stay with that topic of language for just a moment, because it's a favorite topic here on the show, and I know our listeners are pretty savvy about this. And one of the things that comes up early in the show is tort reform. And reform, of course, usually sounds like a good thing. And a tort, as you establish really well in the film, you know, people either think it's a cake or they don't know what it is.
Yeah, most people, you know, really don't even know what a tort is or what tort reform is. But yet people have heard the term so many times that they actually think that it's something that's good for them. And many people are actually embarrassed to say, oh, I don't really know what that means. But what tort reform means, first of all, a tort is a civil harm. When somebody or a corporation or another person harms you in some way and you've suffered damages or an injury that's as a result of that harm, that's called a tort, T-O-R-T. And tort reform is a phrase that was essentially manufactured by, I'm sure, you know, someone like Frank Luntz, you know, who it may not have been him particularly, but someone like him, a wordsmither, you know, who does these focus groups where they determine, you know, what words will tweak people's emotions, like lawsuit lottery, you know, frivolous lawsuit, jackpot justice. And what happens is that they then repeat these words over and over again, and they put it in print ads, they'll put it in radio commercials, television commercials. There were even billboards that were put up in front of courthouses so that potential jurors who are walking into the courthouse when they're about to be a juror will see these big signs that say, you know, stop frivolous lawsuits, as if there are many, many frivolous lawsuits. And so what happened is that we start to believe as a society that there are all these frivolous lawsuits. And tort reform are all the different ways that we are being restricted or limiting our access to the court system to hold wrongdoers accountable.
Yeah, the billboard that you show in the movie is very striking. Lawsuit lotto, play hot coffee and win millions. On top of everything else, it reveals a certain belittling of the human beings on the other side of the picture. And that's one thing I want to establish for our listeners, that Susan Saladoff, the director of Hot Coffee, who I'm talking to now, you establish, Susan, the facts of the coffee case early on in the show within the first 15 minutes. And then you go on to explore a lot of other ways that images and words have been manipulated so that tort reform seems a very logical thing to do. Arbitration, as opposed to allowing an employer to go to court against an employee to go to court against an employer, is a logical thing to do. It really is. You have to doff your cap to these people. They're really good at this.
Oh, well, you know, they've spent millions and millions of dollars to develop this campaign. And so what you've just described is that the movie actually has four storylines, and each one represents a different way that we as Americans are giving up our constitutional rights to access the court system. And most of us don't even think or care about it until it affects us personally. And one of the ways that you've just described is happening to almost all of us every single day. Every time we buy a product online, every time we get a credit card or a cell phone, if we have a mortgage, a gym membership, we're being asked to sign contracts. And embedded in these contracts, in the fine print, is something called mandatory arbitration. And people don't read it or they don't really know what it means. But what it really means is that if at some point you have a conflict with this company that you've now signed away your rights to, they get to pick the decision maker. They pay for the decision maker. The decision maker doesn't have to give a reason why he or she comes up with the decision. It's completely secretive and there's no right to appeal. So you and I, the consumers, we hardly ever win because the arbitrator or the decision maker has an incentive to rule in favor of the company that is paying them and who's picking them because they want to be paid and picked again. And so very, very few consumers win these kinds of cases, and yet we're signing away these rights. In some situations in hospitals, when you sign a consent form, you're now being asked to sign one of these mandatory arbitration clauses. So it's really outrageous, and it's happening all the time.
Well, again, it's the power of the word. Arbitration sounds as though you're going in there with an arbiter, someone who will parse through things. As pointed out in the movie, the arbiter, the firm that is picked for this, will work with the same corporation again and again and again, and they see the person who's got the problem with the corporation exactly once. I mean, the loyalties are going to be pretty clear.
No question about it. The other storyline that people seem to be really shocked by, and it's happening so much, is that this issue of electing judges, you know, the Oliver Diaz story, because mm-hmm. So Oliver Diaz, for your listeners, was a Mississippi State Supreme Court justice who was targeted for defeat because he wasn't pro-corporate enough. And Karl Rove came up with this brilliant idea that in those states where we elect our judges, they have to run for office, they have to raise money, and then they can become beholden to those who give them the most money. And the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which is the largest lobbying group for corporations in the country, if not the world, they figured out that if they can find races, and our state Supreme Courts are, you know, the highest courts in each state, they make the laws essentially for our states. And so if these large corporations can essentially buy judges, which is what's happening, and I'm not kidding about that. I mean, they're essentially able to buy Supreme Court judgeships. And when they do that, they don't have to worry about large verdicts in by the juries, because by the time the case gets to the Supreme Court and it gets overturned.
Now, how does that differ from a system in which an elected official, and we all know that officials, are, you know, political seats are bought and sold regularly. We know that that's out of the hands of the average consumer. So if a politician who's equally bought appoints a judge, how is that different than having the judge elected?
Well, that can be a problem as well. There is a system, it's called the modified Missouri system, that I think actually works well, and it has worked in that state, which is where there's a committee that's essentially has many different types of citizens in it. You know, it has some business people, it has maybe former judges, but different people from different walks of life. And then those people interview all the candidates and then make a recommendation to the governor, maybe three people or something. And then that person gets chosen, one of those three gets chosen by the governor, and then there's a retention election sometime thereafter. And that seems to work, I think, better. There's an organization in Washington, D.C. called Justice at Stake, and they have been really following the insidiousness of these of judicial elections and how really laws are being changed just by the nature of who's sitting on your Supreme Court. We know that at the national level with our U.S. Supreme Court.
We're going to spend the rest of the show with Susan Saladoff. We're going to probe some of these connections between Karl Rove, Big Tobacco. Our good friend Alec actually turns up in this. Alec turns up everywhere. And George W. Bush. And I may someday forgive you, Susan Saladoff, for putting George W. Bush back in my face repeatedly for the course of an hour. One of the groups that you introduce us to is ATRA, the American Tort Reform Association. It's ironic because if you go to their website, their slogan is bringing greater fairness, predictability, and efficiency to the civil justice system. And they certainly have managed to give us the predictability.
Yeah, well, that's their goal. You know, they don't want risk out there, because when there's risk, you know, they have to actually make products that are safe for us, because, you know, otherwise they might be held accountable.
We're going to talk about the movie for the rest of the hour. Susan Saladoff. The movie is Hot Coffee, originally released on HBO in 2011. It's still making the rounds and, in fact, has garnered some new awards in just the past month. We'll talk more about that as we continue here on In Deep. You can find us online, indeepradio.com. I'm Angie Coiro.
Senator Franken.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for calling this hearing, Mr. DiBernardo. You said that the net result of the use of arbitration is a better workplaces.
Correct.
Better workplaces.
Correct.
She was housed with 400 men. She told KBR twice that she was being sexually harassed. She was drugged by men that the KBR employment people knew did this kind of thing. She was raped, gang raped. She had to have reconstructive surgery, sir. They had this arbitration. And then she was locked in a shipping container. Now, my question to you is, if that's a better workplace, what was the workplace like before?
I could put up some
Welcome back to In Deep. I'm Angie Coiro. We're talking about the movie Hot Coffee, which delves into tort reform, arbitration, purchase judges, in essence, a conglomeration of facts that put you as the consumer on the short end of a very long stick. It's the idea that, well, once upon a time, if someone had wronged you or you perceived that someone had wronged you, you as a consumer or as an individual could go to the court system, put your facts before a judge or a jury or both, and let them decide on the merits of that particular case what damages and compensation you might have coming to you. Now, that has been a situation that's devolved over the past two decades to the point now where much of what you can do, much of what you're not allowed to do, and much of the money that you otherwise would have been allowed to receive is being capped by groups that are behind so-called tort reform. I'm talking to the movie maker Susan Saladoff about that. We have links up on our website where you can see clips from the movie. You can find out where current showings might be and a list of very impressive awards, I might add, for which congratulations, Susan Saladoff.
Thank you. It's been quite exciting. And for your viewers who or your listeners, the website is hotcoffeethemovie.com, and that's where they can get all the information that they need.
Let's talk a little bit more about something, the American Tort Reform Association, and that is a conglomeration of businesses, and as one person in the movie says, I was surprised to hear this, universities, but some of the powers behind it we're very familiar with from other legislation that works to harm the consumer, and that is tobacco companies, and Karl Rove, and George W. Bush, and the American Legislative Exchange Council, which our listenership knows an awful lot about. This is not a group where the consumer is well represented.
No. What's really interesting is that, Karl Rove is a brilliant person, scary, but brilliant. And he came up with this idea that it was when George Bush was running for governor, and he realized that there was an issue that could galvanize money from not just Texas, from literally all over the country. And that was this issue of limiting liability for corporations in the court system. And so what he did was is that he came up with this campaign, this tort reform campaign, which would then garner money from corporations all over the country and funnel it into this into Texas to help George Bush become governor so that he would make this one of his primary issues, which is to limit access to the court system for average Americans, which then limits the liability of these large corporations when they make products that harm us. And then, of course, when Governor Bush was elected president of the United States, he took that issue right to the national stage. And so it became one of the primary and first issues that George Bush brought to his presidency. And so when you listen to, as you saw in the film, when you listen to the State of the Union addresses, every year, he's always talking about, frivolous lawsuits, class action reform, all of these ways of limiting liability. And all of that was so that he could get more money from more groups that were not just initially not just in Texas.
It's a real exercise in watching people create an other. If you see yourself in the shoes of the consumer as someone who might be wronged by a careless doctor, as someone who might be hurt by a product that wasn't made to proper specifications, then you're going to empathize with the person who wants a full and open court system. If that person becomes a cartoon to you, if that person becomes the greedy lady with predictably hot coffee in her lap, it's much harder to realize it's you they're talking about taking rights away from.
People are always, critical of these types of cases when it's someone else's case. As you just said, very few people really get it until it affects them personally or a close family member. I mean, an example of this is the former candidate for the Republican Party, Rick Santorum. He was a huge supporter of tort reform and was supporting a national effort to put a $250,000 cap on pain and suffering damages in medical malpractice cases until, of course, his wife was the subject of a medical malpractice injury. And when she brought a lawsuit, she brought it for an amount that was higher than the cap that he was proposing. And then, of course, he supported his wife in that effort. And this is typical. I mean, when I practiced law for 25 years, and people would come into my office and the first thing that they would say is, I'm not a litigious person. They'd almost be embarrassed for wanting to exercise their constitutional rights to hold someone accountable that injured them. And people are like, you know, my case is legitimate, but, you know, I know that there are all those frivolous cases out there, and I'll say, well, name one for me, you know, and then sometimes they'll name the McDonald's coffee case. And then I say, well, do you really know the facts of that case?
And so there's another one that gets mentioned in the film that certainly didn't have that level of publicity, but of all people, it was mentioned by Ronald Reagan in a national presentation. And Ronald Reagan cited the case of a man who was in a phone booth. The phone booth was hit by a drunk driver, and he turned around and he sued the phone company. And how peculiar is that, to pick the phone company? The implication, of course, being the phone company has the deep pockets. That's the only reason to go after them. Now, what was the truth behind that story?
Well, the truth was that this particular phone booth was in a very bad position, and so it was being hit regularly by cars. And when the company, when the phone company went to fix the phone booth, when the man who was in the phone booth tried to get out because he saw the car coming at him, he couldn't get the door open because the phone booth had been hit so many times, the door was stuck. And so the reason why he sued the phone company was because of the fact that he couldn't get out of the phone booth, not because, you know, the door opened, he would not have been hit. And he wound up, you know, being very severely injured. I think he lost his legs, and, you know, it was a horrible, horrible injury. And President Reagan made fun of it, you know, as if this is some joke. And these are not jokes when it's you or your family member and when there's a legitimate case. But, you know, there's all this media attention for, oh, did you hear the one about the guy? You know, he's driving an RV and he puts it on cruise control, and then he goes back to make a cup of coffee, and then he gets into an accident, and, you know, and then he goes and sues the company, as if these are real cases. Mm-hmm. But they're not. They're made up. They're made up out of whole cloth, but yet they're repeated by groups like the American Tort Reform Association, or these Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse groups, or the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, but they never put them in their own names. You know, they'll put out these messages with front groups like Citizens for a Stronger Community or Citizens for a Safer Environment or whatever. They'll make up these front group names, never telling anybody who's behind the effort and where the money's coming from.
Yeah, in fact, the politicizing of this whole topic was by groups that we now recognize as astroturfing, where there's a national interest group that puts out little sprouts nowadays on the internet, less so at that point, but they all look like state organizations. They all look spontaneous. They look as though they arose from the people themselves, and they're nothing of the sort.
Not at all. In fact, the most ironic thing that happened is 2 days before we premiered the film for the first time at the Sundance Film Festival last year, I was at a party and I started talking to this woman, and I told her about the film, and she said, oh, I used to work in tort reform. And I said, really? What does that mean? And she goes, oh, yeah. You know, I said, did you work for an insurance company? And she said, no. And I said, well, did you work for Big Tobacco? And she goes, you know about that? And I said, of course I know about that. It's in the film. And she goes, that's in the film? I said, yeah, the Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse groups that were set up by tobacco. She goes, I started those. And I said, what? I've been looking for you. She said, yeah, I worked for the public relations firm, and it was my idea to come up with those Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse groups. And I said to her, well, what about the guy in Texas? Because I was going to go interview this guy in Texas who I thought was the person who started them. And she goes, oh, no, I hired him.
Oh, my gosh.
Is that amazing to, like, meet this person 2 days before the film is premiering? And I asked her, I said, why did you do this? And she goes, I was young and I needed the money.
Oh, God. Wow.
Yeah, that's what it is. You know, people think, oh, Citizens Against Lawsuit Abuse, as if there are actual citizens in it. No, it's a group that was manufactured by a public relations company to, as you said, as an astroturf group, to convince people that there's this spontaneous grassroots of a movement by small business owners and all these things to get people to think that there's a problem. And the problem is that corporations want to limit people's access to the court system where they can be held accountable. That's the problem.
And we're going to continue with Susan Saladoff, director of Hot Coffee. And with her directing that film, she's actually continuing her career that started as a public interest lawyer for a group called Trial Lawyers for Public Justice. That's still around. It's now known as Public Justice, and it's an organization that, quote, is at the forefront of keeping America's courthouse doors open to all for the last 30 years. She served as its president in 2002. Coming back with more of In Deep, stick around. I'm Angie Coiro.
Jackpot justice.
Predatory trial lawyers at it again.
Junk lawsuits over frivolous injuries.
Lawsuit lottery and jackpot justice and frivolous lawsuits. These were bumper sticker phrases that were easy to market and use to move public sentiment away from a strong civil justice system.
The whole issue is that the industry does not want the public generally to have access to the courts.
Thanks for tuning in this week to In Deep with Angie Coiro, a production of Talkback Studios. You can get more information about us at indeepradio.com. And while you're there, you can become a member and support our work. There's a link there to contact us, too, with any questions or feedback. We're developing a series on mental health issues in our country, especially in this economy, and we'd love to have you be part of that. Please send us your topic suggestions, your stories, and your questions through our website. Click the contact button at indeepradio.com. Join us again this time next week for two more hours of in-depth conversation. I'm Angie Coiro. We'll see you then. This is In Deep. I'm Angie Coiro, talking to director Susan Saladoff about her film Hot Coffee, which is an examination of tort reform, arbitration clauses, purchased judges, and a lot of details about the way your rights are being curtailed as a consumer that you probably don't know about. Susan Saladoff, you mentioned earlier in the interview the figure of $250,000, which is a cap in some regions, in a lot of states and areas, for how much you can be rewarded, whereas if this were totally left up to the jury, there would be considerations about how much money you've actually lost and what punitive damages are. Punitive damages serve a very specific function in these court cases. First of all, where does this $250,000 cap come from? How is that number arrived at?
So let me start by saying there are three different kinds of damages that a person can get when they've been injured by another in these types of cases. One are what we call like your medical bills and your wage losses, which are we call special damages. They're the actual numbers that you have, like bills and so forth. And then there's something called pain and suffering, which is an amount of money that is supposed to make you whole in some way. Like if you've lost a leg or, you know, if you've, you know, have lost, you know, your ability to have a child or something as a result of someone else's negligence, then in addition to the medical bills, you're entitled to receive some kind of compensation to make you whole. I mean, you can't get your leg back, but maybe you could, you know, get money to make your life a little bit more comfortable. Those are called pain and suffering, sometimes called non-economic damages. And then there's a third type of damages, which are called punitive damages. And punitive damages are very rare. And what they are intended to do is to punish a defendant or a company or someone who causes harm when they've done it either intentionally, recklessly, maliciously. And so it's a punishment and also a deterrent to make sure that they don't do that conduct again, that if they're being assessed a large amount of money, then they will change their conduct, hopefully, so that they won't be assessed that money again. So those are the three types of damages. Many, many states have what we call caps on all. Some of them have caps on all of these damages. Mm-hmm. Some have caps just on the pain and suffering, and some have caps on the punitive, and some have a combination. And what this means is that there's a legislative body, you know, Congress, that's putting a one-size-fits-all number on all cases in that state. That regardless of what the injury was, how old the person was, what the extent of the negligence was. So basically, you know, as you saw in the film, there's a story of Colin Gourley, who is suffered a horrendous birth injury and has to live his entire life with cerebral palsy, very limited ability to live his life normally.
Well, in fact, I wanted to establish that one of the things that I'd like you to cover as we discuss Colin. One of the things that I think works against the consumer is when they hear, in as you're about to tell us his case, the amount of money that he received or was, you know, hoping to receive for his lifelong care sounds enormous. It sounds like a lottery win. So tell us, as you tell us the story of Colin, tell us where they arrived at the figure that would have been perhaps just to take care of him for his life.
So Colin was a twin. His mother was pregnant with identical twin boys, and they were in one placenta. And what happened was is that the pregnancy was going along normally until the very end of the pregnancy, when she started having limited movement of the babies. And so she went to the doctor, and they did a test, and the doctor said everything seemed fine, but the babies were continuing to have less movement and less movement. And finally, it was determined that the babies had something called a twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome, where one baby was getting everything and the other baby's getting nothing because they only had one umbilical cord. And the doctor said that the babies should be delivered right away. And had the babies been delivered right away, they would have both been perfectly healthy according to the medical information and what the jury found. But what happened was that there was a delay for a variety of reasons, and the babies were not born timely. And as a result, Colin suffered a tremendous injury by not having enough oxygen. And so there were two babies born, one perfectly healthy and one with a brain injury. And so Colin is now living the rest of his life, you know, with severe physical and mental disabilities. He's had over 11 surgeries in his life. He's had to, you see in the film, it's a tremendous injury. And so he lives in Nebraska. And his family went to court and filed a lawsuit, and they won. The jury found that the doctors were negligent and awarded the family $5.65 million. Now, that sounds like a lot of money, but that's the amount of money that would take care of this child for the rest of his life. All the medical bills, his physical therapy, his equipment that he needs, all the things that he will need to live a relatively normal life, but just the medical bills. And yet in Nebraska, they had a cap on all damages of $1.25 million. So this $5.65 million verdict was reduced to $1.25 million. And then after medical bills are paid and the lawyers are paid, Colin winds up with just a few hundred thousand dollars. Well, what the truth means about that is that he's still going to need all this medical care. So who pays for it? Instead of the insurance company and the doctor that caused the harm, the taxpayers pay for it through Medicare and Medicaid, because he's going to need to get that same care. And now you and I wind up paying for it, as opposed to the responsible party, who, by the way, had insurance.
Susan Saladoff, we're going to unpack a little more of that story. There's so much in it as we continue here on In Deep. We're discussing the film Hot Coffee. You're going to find all the information you need and all the links for information about Hot Coffee at our website, indeepradio.com. And you can follow us on Facebook, by the way, In Deep with Angie Coiro. We'll be right back.
In a broke down shack by the railroad track, I could hear so crying. That whistle crying. The devil, she's out to get me. I know I can't be saved. Darkness creeps up in my sleep and leads me to...
We're talking in this hour of In Deep with Susan Saladoff. She's the director of the documentary Hot Coffee. If you have HBO, you can see that. We'll have more information how you can see it as we wrap up the hour here on In Deep. First, to the conversation again. I'm Angie Coiro. Thanks for tuning in. Susan, you were just telling us the story of twins that were born to parents, one of whom was badly mentally and physically damaged because of doctor and other procedural medical errors. And we talked about the way the cap affected them. One thing in that story that I was surprised to learn in the documentary is that juries are asked in many cases to consider how much money rightfully goes to the consumer without being aware that caps are in effect. I mean, the jury can do its work and say it's going to take $5.7 million to support this boy through the rest of his life, you know, to let him have care, to let him have the repeated surgeries that he continues to have. And they feel like, as a jury, they've done their job. And then almost retroactively, in the way it works, here comes the law that kind of kicks it in the butt and says, okay, they get, you know, $1.7 million and that's it.
Yeah, the judge applies the cap after the verdict, so the jury never knows that there's a cap, although there are caps on damages in almost all of our states. I think like two-thirds of the states have a cap on one sort or another. And there's so much of a myth about this because people think, oh, well, the cap will, you know, lower doctors' premiums for help for liability insurance, for example. And just the opposite is true. I mean, in those states where there have been caps, the insurance rates do not go down. The insurance companies just make more money. People think that healthcare costs will go down when you limit people's ability to get full compensation in the courtroom. And just the opposite is happening in Texas, where essentially you can't bring a medical malpractice case in Texas because they've limited your ability to do that in so many ways since 2003. And yet healthcare costs have gone up at a rate higher than the national average. In California, you know, where many of your listeners will be, there's been a $250,000 cap on pain and suffering in medical malpractice cases since like the mid-1970s. It's never been increased. There's not even a cost of living adjustment for it. And so essentially, it's so difficult to bring a medical malpractice case in California unless you have very large medical bills or wage loss, because it's just cost so much money to bring these cases, and it's very difficult to find someone who's willing to put up all that money when there's such a limited when the risk benefit analysis is so out of balance.
One of the factors that struck me during the movie, and you were just talking about how these ideas are proposed and they're sold to both to their proponents and to the consumers who have to vote on them. They're sold as something that would bring medical rates down or at least prevent them from going up. But the money ends up in the pockets of the insurance companies and stays there. And the person who's caught in the middle here is the doctor. And you know any number of people who literally leave the business because they're so burdened by insurance or so burdened by how bad our healthcare system is. They're being sold a bill of good as well, it seems, because they seem to buy the idea. We see the American Medical Association in film clips here applauding the idea from George Bush that, you know, I am going to enforce this tort reform. I am behind this all the way. And when I see them applauding that, I feel like, you know, you're the dupes. You're not going to be any better off when this happens.
They're being fed a bill of goods just like the rest of us. I mean, and it's not just in this area. You know, it's in many areas. I mean, I'm working on another film now about the pharmaceutical industry, and you know, it's like there's so much marketing and messaging, and they're so good at it. These large corporations. I mean, they have really gotten this down to a science. I was in my an OBGYN's office, and there was this big sign on like a poster on the wall in my doctor's office saying, you know, stop lawsuit abuse or prevent frivolous lawsuits. And I'm thinking, oh my goodness, this is in my doctor's office? Mm. And, you know, and when I would talk to my doctor about it, you know, she was completely, you know, believed that somehow this was going to affect, you know, her insurance rates or healthcare costs. And that's just not the way it works. I mean, that's the messaging that's been fed to us, but it's not the reality.
Tell me how your doctor reacted to the information that you had at hand, where you could say, look, this isn't the case.
Well, she was surprised, but, you know, wanted to be convinced. Because the messaging is so pervasive, and it's not, you know, but when doctors have seen the film, defense lawyers have seen the film, even members of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, you know, have commented to me that, you know, when people see the film, they actually, some people, you know, they get it for the first time. I mean, there have been people who have come up to me and said, you know, I've been practicing law for 40 years and, you know, I did this kind of work, but until my wife saw your film, she didn't really get what I did. And I think that the reason why people are able, look, not everybody's going to agree with everything that's in the film, but it presents another point of view that most people don't know. And even when there are, you know, people come up and criticize me and some, you know, very few people do, but some do, and they say, well, your film is one-sided. And I always say, well, you know, everybody knows the other side. They don't know this side. And when I practice law, before I would ask a jury to render a verdict, I would ask them to listen to both sides of the story. You'd never ask anyone to render a verdict or come to a decision only hearing one side. But yet for 30 years, the American public has heard one side of this issue. And hot coffee gives them a different perspective. And then, you know, you get to decide on your own.
Let's talk about the story that you saved for last in the movie. And the movie is Hot Coffee. I'm talking to director Susan Saladoff here on In Deep. This is the case of Jamie Lee Jones, and it's a real mixed bag of a story. This is the young woman, 19 years old at the time, that she alleged that she was raped by KBR, and KBR was a division of Halliburton, and it was her work overseas that put her in this situation. We can't go into all the details of what happened to her, but it was just, you know, egregious offense piled on egregious offense, and her case was finally championed by, among others, one of her representatives, and that's Al Franken. And what happened ultimately, the film, of course, made its debut last year. And subsequently, although she finally managed to bust through this arbitration clause business because it was given such a high profile, and she did go before a jury, and she lost. And although that's still tied up in the system, KBR is trying to recover $2 million in attorney fees from this young woman. It shows us that this is a convoluted issue that even when we break through what's happening on the side of the corporations, there are no guaranteed happy endings here.
Well, you know, we can never guarantee what's going to happen in front of a jury. You know, there's so many variables. What the section of the movie is intended to inform the public about are these mandatory arbitration clauses that are in our employment contracts, our, you know, our real estate contracts, our cell phone. I mean, every contract. I mean, this is so ironic. When I was applying to the Sundance Film Festival, it was an online application, and I had to check off that box that said, you know, I agree with the terms. And one of them was a mandatory arbitration clause, which was so crazy because I did not want to sign it. You know,
that is irony.
But I didn't have a choice. I mean, you don't have a choice when you're buying anything online these days. You have to check off that little box. You know, whoever reads it, you know, the terms, I agree to the terms and conditions. And
right.
Embedded in almost all of them are these mandatory arbitration clauses. And so what I want to let consumers know, let the American public know, is that this is the newest and most pervasive way that we are being asked, not even asked, that we are voluntarily handing over our constitutional rights to access the court system by a jury of our peers every time we're being asked to sign these contracts. And we're not even being asked in many times, because just by using your cell phone or using your credit card, you are now subject to these clauses. And so what I want people to understand is, number one, we've got to get these clauses out of our contracts. And the only way to do that is essentially through legislation. I mean, there are times when we can cross them out. You know, like I have a real estate, put my house on the market. And when my realtor had one of these clauses in the contract, I said, well, I'm not going to use you unless this clause comes out. And so I crossed it out and put my initials, and she accepted that. So there are ways of negotiating. But many times we don't have that ability. And so what we need to do is we need to get these clauses out of our contracts. And there is a bill pending both before the House and the Senate. It's called the Arbitration Fairness Act. And we need to go and tell our representatives to support that legislation to get these clauses out of our contracts.
You know, the argument that you hear against arbitration clauses, for example, let's go back to the KBR story. There were people who argued at the time, look, you signed this contract. It's not their fault if you didn't read what you were signing. And you still hear that. And the second part of that argument is, don't take that job. Get a different job. Get a different credit card. Go work for some other company.
Yeah, well, it's very easy to say that, but you know, you won't find a credit card that doesn't have one of these arbitration clauses. And when people need a job, that's the last thing they're going to be doing is trying to negotiate out something that they don't really even understand what it means or think it's ever going to apply to them. I mean, nobody ever thinks anything bad is going to happen. And we sign these away. And again, remember, it's usually in the fine print, and sometimes these contracts are pages long, or sometimes with a credit card, for example, you're not given even the contract when you get the credit card. Subsequently, like a month or two later, in with the bill is, you know, change of the terms of your contract. You remember seeing those kinds of things, like it's a little insert.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever reads those? I mean, and even if you did, what kind of leverage do you have? You don't have any leverage to ask the company to change that. And so we're at the mercy of these large corporations, and we don't, and again, nobody really cares or thinks about it until it affects us. And then when it does affect us, we go, wait a second, I thought I lived in a democracy. You know, I thought that we had fair laws in this country. And then you realize that you've signed it away, but how most people don't even understand what the words arbitration even means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as we established earlier in this hour, for anyone who hasn't heard the whole thing, the show is always archived at indeepradio.com. You know, the very fact of the word arbitration makes it sound like a much more fair system than it was. And we covered that extensively earlier in the hour. Let me ask you about the small occurrence of actual lawsuits that one might deem frivolous and how those work against the case for reexamining issues of tort reform, arbitration, et cetera. Here in California, Dianne Feinstein, Senator Feinstein, has come out against what they call drive-by lawsuits. And these are cases well established. They've been covered in a number of media of people who scout out restaurants and businesses that don't have approved ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act access. They're not people who are really attempting to use that restaurant. They're not people who really care to access that business. And there are people who literally make a living from this, seeking out the businesses and suing for access on more the theory that they ought to be acceptable or the legality that they ought to be acceptable. But some appear to be primarily doing it as a means of making a living. The money doesn't get shared with organizations. It doesn't get shared with, you know, spreading the word about access. It goes in these people's pockets. Is that a legitimate thing to call a frivolous lawsuit?
You know, I think that there are always bad apples in every system. You know, you're not going to – there's no system that's perfect. And, you know, you can't – what they say, what's that expression, throw out the baby with the bathwater? I mean,
yes.
You're not going to, you know, change an entire system because there are a few people who take advantage of it. And then the question becomes, are there checks and balances in the system that exist to prevent those kinds of things from happening? So for the first thing is that – you know, lawyers who do this kind of work get paid on what's called a contingency fee basis, which means that they only get paid if they win. And if they don't win, not only have they put up this money and their time, but then they potentially, you know, lose money and they don't make any money. So it's very unlikely that a lawyer will represent someone who has a non-meritorious case, okay? But let's say you find someone who does. Then the first question is there a checks and balance in the system when the case is filed? So there are many laws in our states at the state level and also at the federal level that says that if a person files a non-meritorious case, that the judge can throw it out and fine both the person who brought it and potentially the lawyer. So that's the next check. Then you've got a jury of 12 people who are going to listen to both sides of the case and then determine whether or not that person is deserving of an award and what that amount should be. And so you've got that check. then even if the jury makes a mistake, you've got a judge who can overturn that verdict, just like you saw in the McDonald's case. You know, the judge reduced the verdict to an amount that was different from what the jury had awarded. And then even if the judge doesn't do that, then you've got an appeal and an appeal. There are so many checks and balances in the system that there are very few cases, if any, that are non-meritorious or frivolous, so to speak, that actually win or get through the system entirely.
And I think that points up something that you underlined in the film a number of times, was that these things that are set up ostensibly to protect the consumer actually harm the consumer in that they remove the freedoms of the jury. And the jury is set up as part of our legal system to determine the legitimacy and the depth of importance and the fiscal, you know, amount of harm in any given case. And when you go to telling the jury how to do their business, you're cutting off the rights of that accrued by the legal system.
Well, it's not just the legal system, it's in our Constitution. I mean, you know, how many people know what the Seventh Amendment to the Constitution is? You know, we know the First Amendment and we know the Second, but the Seventh Amendment is trial by jury. And so our founding fathers understood the importance of having a jury of our peers decide in these types of cases what is an appropriate amount of damages and what's an appropriate way that people should be compensated. And so this is a fundamental part of our democracy. You know, at the very beginning of the film, I don't know if you remember, I have that animation, that sort of the cartoon. Do you remember that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I did that very intentionally as a cartoon, the way that we would see it either in like, you know, in elementary school and like with children. This is what we're taught as children, that we have three branches of government. We have our executive branch, our legislative branch, and our court system. And that is our checks and balances in our democracy. And what's happened, unfortunately, is that, you know, our executive branch and our legislative branch, as we all know, have been, you know, influenced by money and power. But most people think that you still have a fair way of getting justice, which is in our court system. And what the movie unfortunately shows is that our court system as well is now being manipulated by money and power. And so we're essentially losing all three branches of our democracy unless we as Americans first understand it and then take back our rights, insist that we take back our rights. But the only way we can do that is if we actually understand what's happening to us.
Susan Saladoff, it's been a fabulous hour illuminating, and I want to let people know that we have on our website links to clips to the show, to action items that can be taken by people inspired by the show, and to your appearance on Stephen Colbert, which is on your own website as well. And I thank you so much for the time.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much.
Susan Saladoff is the director of Hot Coffee, a documentary about tort reform, arbitration, and all kinds of other things you really need to know about, as we hope our entire show is. That's a wrap for this week. Our executive producer is Gordon Whiting. Our engineer is Matt Fidler. Assistant producer, Cindy Myers. Jill Fidler is queen of the universe. Our incredible interns are Forrest Phillips, Kristen Stevens, and Megan Mina. You can follow us on Twitter, @InDeepRadio. We're on Facebook, In Deep with Angie Coiro. And you can send us feedback, suggestions, cash at our website, indeepradio.com. Our theme is by Big Troubles, closing theme by David Gans, and our website is crammed with web extras from Gotta Laugh and More. Do visit. We'll see you next week. Thanks for being here. I'm Angie Coiro.
It's gonna get worse before it gets better. It's gonna get worse before it gets better, but I know it's gonna get better.
Thanks for tuning in this week to In Deep with Angie Coiro, a production of Talkback Studios. You can get more information about us at indeepradio.com. And while you're there, you can become a member and support our work. There's a link there to contact us, too, with any questions or feedback. We're developing a series on mental health issues in our country, especially in this economy, and we'd love to have you be part of that. Please send us your topic suggestions, your stories, and your questions through our website. Click the contact button at indeepradio.com. Join us again this time next week for two more hours of in-depth conversation. I'm Angie Coiro. We'll see you then. You're listening to WPWC, 1480 AM, Dumfries, Virginia. We Act Radio, home of Washington's progressive working community.